April 6, 2016 meeting of the Community Preservation Committee. We're spending the majority of our meeting listening to you folks comment on the wonderful proposals that are before us for this meeting. We begin, as we do each meeting, with general public comment. These are comments not having to do with specific proposals, but if anyone has general CPA stuff to talk about or anything for our attention, is there someone out there? No? In that case, we have no minutes or chair's report, so we will move right into the public comment session, which is what you all are here for. So as you all know, we have our work cut out for us on this committee. We get lots of wonderful proposals, and the good news is they're all worthy of funding. The bad news is we don't have the money to fund all of them. So your comments are very much appreciated. We certainly take them into consideration in our difficult task of deciding what to fund and how to allocate our resources. So we thank all of you for coming and sharing your thoughts with us, but do acknowledge and know that it is difficult, sometimes impossible, for us to fund everything, and we do so taking into consideration that it is often a very worthy proposal. We simply don't have the money to fund everything. So I think we'll start with, I'm just going to go through the list of projects in no particular order. I don't see any kids here, is that right? Sometimes we have proposals with children, we try to get them in first, given school nights, but in the absence of children, we will move right along. We ask you to come up to the podium if you are able and state your name and your address, if you will. We will do this by proposal. Some of you may wish to speak to more than one or multiple proposals, and you're certainly encouraged to do that. We try to keep folks' comments to just a few minutes. If it goes on and on and on, I will take the liberty of smiling kindly and saying thank you very much. But we don't have too many people here, so that will not be an issue. So I think we'll just go down right in the order of what Sarah, our CONSCOM and Community Preservation Committee gave us, and begin with the Pulaski Park Overlook project. Is there someone who wishes to speak to that? Going once, twice, okay. No one for Pulaski. The Shepherd Barn Historic Northampton proposal. Okay, yeah.
Well, I'm a familiar face here to many of you. I'm Kiki Smith, I'm president of the board of Historic Northampton, which has greatly benefited from your generosity, two grants now in a row. The second grant, this issue about the renovation of the Shepherd Barn was not funded, and so we're coming back again for that. We are also recognizing you have many, you have many demands on your budget this time around. And as was discussed by a few of you who came by to look at the barn recently, the schedule to renovate the barn would really not start until the spring. So hoping we don't have a huge snowfall, we are willing to assume that we would reapply in the fall, in this case, with the one request if you would please consider funding the dendrochronology of the barn, which is a small piece of it, it's $2,000, which would mean that this summer and we could ascertain more clearly what the age of the building is, and therefore even more clearly what its importance is. And if we had that before we reapply, just giving you fair warning, in the fall, we would have an even more informed application. So I would humbly submit that to your consideration.
So, Kiki, we're taking this as a formal request to reduce funding to $2,000, is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. Are there, given that this is a change in proposal, maybe we could see if there are any additional questions to Kiki about that? Is that appropriate at this point? Yes, any committee members?
Is that a proposal that you have ready to go for 2,000? Is that number tied to a specific?
Well, it was part, it is written into that proposal as part of the bigger chunk. But we realize, obviously, that the sooner we know that information, the better.
Kiki, Chris, thanks for showing up tonight. I was happy to be there last group, 2 weeks ago. Do you have any concerns about the condition of the building, if we were to lay it, what that might have? Because I noticed at one point, you know, it's open to the sky.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any interim plans to safeguard structure?
Well, I suppose if we could at least maybe, we may have a little pocket change, but if we could get maybe a little bit more to make sure that all the slates are in place. Mm-hmm. But I have to admit that I haven't looked into that specifically in the proposal. And all I can say is, since you particularly recognize the tenuousness of some of those posts and beams, hope that we have not a heavy snow this fall, this winter. But it's just so hard to know what we could do temporarily now that wouldn't get us would really literally open it up to exposure even more.
Thanks.
Any other questions?
Well, first, let me say it's refreshing that you understand where we are with this. And, and also, I want to mention that I'm really excited about your new leadership. I think that would have been one of our questions is, how do we know that funding spent in that organization is going to pay off? And I'm confident it is now, so I'm really excited. Programming's up. The barn would receive more programming that would allow you to do that. I think that there's probably some uncertainty around the $2,000. I'd like to see the building closed up to rain.
Yes.
And then just a question, is a temporary house jack or anything on that major joint that is having so much trouble, would that ensure it getting through?
I would have to consult with Chris.
Yep.
And I know you guys are under some kind of a time limit here, and I don't know how best I could respond to that.
I understand.
But I would be glad to find that out, and I could email Sarah to just to inform you all. I'd really appreciate that opportunity, actually.
Yeah.
For some kind of a sealing up of the ceiling, which you saw the sky in, and you're right, some kind of a structure to hold it together.
Yeah, I think we previously talked about the fact that there's no way to partially fix the barn.
Right.
But when we're talking about just supporting it through one more season while we get to it,
that
might
be
a way to think about it.
So I will find that information out. I'll send it to you all in hopes that you can consider
it. Sending it to Sarah would be great.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Keith.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank
you
very much.
Other folks speaking on the Shepherd Barn?
What a segue.
You're welcome.
I'm Lori Sanders, and I'm one of the new co-directors. We'll be beginning it on May 1st at Historic Northampton. And I want to echo the support for the project that Kiki described. It's that thin piece, which I think, as many of you know, that lots of great things have been happening at Historic Northampton for the last year and a half. And I think one of the pieces getting to your comment, Devin, is that one of the goals that Betty and I have for this next 6 months is really thinking with the board and lots of community members strategically about what is the organization going to do. And part of that is really looking at all the buildings and having a piece of information that informs what is the age of the barn, how important is it from a historical significance, is really going to inform what we do with that piece in the future. And I think one of the other pieces that in response largely to the newspaper article both Betty and I have received feedback from folks in the community. And one of the pieces that we've talked with Kiki and other board members about is really pulling together a team of experts from the Valley, a lot of folks from Northampton, who can go with us through those buildings and look and kind of help prioritize, right, what are the pieces, what's the key step, you know. So I think having the dendrochronology and the age data will also help us, and then with this other larger team, we'll really be able to identify, okay, what's next? Do we have to instantly, you know, shore pieces up? So anyway, it would be wonderful to have that piece of funding so that we can answer that key piece of question. And thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
Well, Lars, thank you.
Congratulations, by the way.
Thank you.
I'm
very
delighted
much
to see this industry's responsibility. Dendrochronology is often used simply to date. Given your expertise, it can also give us insight into the natural history of the Valley. And this can also, and every bit of dendrochronology done at the Historic Northampton can actually tell us about what was happening in the valley's forest up until that time. Can that be included in this one?
You're spot on, because I've been just reading the journals of Sylvester Judd, which is a little bit later, but he has terrific information about what's happening at the sawmills. And one of the pieces that's there, which now at our current landscape, we would have sort of no awareness of, is a quantity of yellow pine, which is the synonym for pitch pine. And so understanding, like, what are the species in that piece of the building, but also in the Parsons, you know, it's going to be really interesting to try and get at those numbers and try to think, okay, so when this tree sprouted, what was happening in Northampton, and then connecting that to current landscape, all those pieces along the way. So you're right, there's going to be a terrific educational component to it in addition to just a structural.
Thank you, Laura.
Thank you very much.
Anybody else for the Shepherd Barn? Okay, moving on to the Academy of Music and the Historic Curtain.
Good evening, I'm Deborah J. Anthony, the Executive Director of the Academy of Music. And I'm standing before you with a reapplication for the 1913 Maurice Tuttle Scenic Curtain. Last time I stood before you, many of you had not had an opportunity to see the curtain. However, about a month ago, many of you came out for a site visit and were able to see what I had described to you as an urgent situation to conserve the curtain now that it's exposed and away from the main rag. You were able to see the lead clamps that are pulling on the fabric and how it's not protected anymore from another piece of fabric in front of it, and it needs to be cleaned and conserved and cared for. And also we need a new frame built around it, one that is lighter than the one that it has right now. There's no protection on the sides, actually. It's just pulling down with the clamps and the wires on the side. And we have that very heavy wooden board that's also stretching the fabric. So I'm asking you for a strong consideration for this project this round. And also, if some urgency to hear, so that we hear about whether or not we will be funded, so that we can secure the conservators. We're hoping we have a time frame of the summer of 4 weeks to work on the project and prepare it for the public. We're very excited about conserving this curtain, and hopefully that we will get your support this round.
Thank you, Doug. Somebody else on the Academy of Music?
Okay. Keith Smith back again, wearing two hats, actually. One of them from Historic Northampton, and one as a professor in the theater department at Smith College. This, at the end of most shows, everything gets trashed, disappears, gone forever. And if there isn't a photograph of it, it's gone. This is amazing, this particular image that's there. It's amazing as a piece of history of theater, which warms my heart, particularly in an era of video and where this style of theater performance is not at the moment in its ascendance, shall we say. It probably come back, but nonetheless. And it, so as a theater person, I find it a really extraordinary gem. And so is the Academy of Music. So the combination of the two of those is a pretty remarkable opportunity, I think, to see. From the point of view of history of Northampton, all that I've learned from being on the board, and I've got a lot more to learn about the history of Northampton, in one little corner up there, in this blissful looking bucolic arrangement, is a factory that used to be right next door to where my theater building is, that made, among other things, hose, the H-O-E, not H-O-S-E, which was being produced down here on West Street, but hose, they were being shipped south for the slaves to use. Now, for me, as a costume designer, as a textile person, as a historian here in Northampton, that's a pretty cool little emblem, one corner of that particular piece, that makes it not just some kind of a dramatic illusion, but really something specific about this city. So I heartily endorse this request and hope you all will seriously consider it. Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Any else for the Academy of Music? Okay, moving on to Broadbrook Coalition and the Invasives Control.
Hi, I'm Jim Reese from 108 Point Valley Road in Northampton. And first of all, I'm a BBC member. Well, first of all, I want to thank you all and the city for all the past support that you've given for these projects. This is an invasive control project that we're requesting money for. As the co-chair of the Trails Committee, I spend a lot of time out there, and I can tell you that the efforts that you've supported have really been successful. We wonder sometimes even how invasives are so incredibly intrusive in so many areas, but the past success of the efforts that have been funded have really paid off. What we're focusing on now, this request here, is for Cook's Pasture and the Dam. And the reason for that is, as you probably know, Massachusetts is becoming more and more reforested, and so pasture land and grassland is really an endangered sort of habitat, and you really will only see certain animals and certain birds in that area. So that's why we're focusing on this. This area here, a couple years ago, I was lucky enough to see the woodcock courtship dance there, and Dave Pritchard, right over there, led a walk just on Sunday. As bad as the weather was, even with the weather, with the cold and the wind, they saw what several woodcocks. So,
four or five.
So without this glossy buckthorn and black swallowwort, which is the main sort of invasives in those areas, it really just takes over the whole pasture land. So what we're hoping is to, while there's been some success, there's been some recently identified new areas that need additional work. So there's been some success, but to really deal with some of the more mature trees that are now seeding the area, we really need additional money to take care of those. So I know you've got a serious issue here with all these requests, but we're hoping that you give some, that you're able to support this request. Thanks.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Someone else for bases, yes?
David Pritchard from Havenville, and I'm also a Broward Coalition board member. You have in the application here a very thorough explanation of how this project has proceeded before and why we need to continue with it, and Jim has just spoken of that. I'd just like to make two quick points. One is we have a very active group of volunteers. In fact, the heart of BBC is really its volunteers. They come out regularly, they do a lot of work. It's how I first got involved in the organization. But obviously, when you're talking about invasive plants, there's only so much you can do if you have to have a license to apply the herbicides and things like that. So it's not enough to have the people that we have out pulling. We need to really address this. In that case, I think it's made well in here. The other point I'd like to make is that we sponsor a lot of walks and talks. Jim just alluded to one the other night for woodcocks, where we walked in the dust to Cook's pasture. This is an educational service, really, that we provide to the town. The walks are free. We get pretty good participation in them. We get 7 or 8 a year, local naturalists, including some who are in behind me, lead them. And this is a something, this whole Fitzgerald Lake area, I think, because of its recreational and its educational, not to mention all the environmental value of it, is something really worth protecting. So I would urge you to accept this proposal. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'd like to just echo what David said, and Laurie Sanders again. One of the things that for me is really interesting is in 1993, I looked at all the conservation area at that time in the city of Northampton, and Fitzgerald Lake was then, as it is now, the largest conservation area in Northampton. And one of the things that was really interesting over the 2014-2015 season when I did the project again for the city of Northampton was revisiting many of these properties. And one of the invasives that David mentioned is something called glossy buckthorn, which I had done my master's on. And so I had like little red lights would go off when I'd see glossy buckthorn. And one of the things that's really was fascinating by going to every conservation area in the city in a single year is you see patterns which you wouldn't necessarily otherwise wouldn't otherwise appear. And one of them is just that historical piece in terms of the extent of certain invasives in certain areas. And then also sort of their location, which ones have really bounced up. And in the 20 years ago, swallowwort, which is one of their target species, it wasn't present really at any of the conservation areas in Northampton. Glossy buckthorn at that time, 20 years ago, 1993, was limited to a very small area over near where it's sort of in the Fitzgerald Fence neighborhood. But that is a species that has really spread into the wetland areas and into Cook's pasture, which also has just this great history. It was once owned by Dr. Denniston, which is, many of you are familiar with Denniston Place, which is one of the water cures here in Northampton. Then it was owned by Cook, which is why it's called Cook Avenue. Anyway, there's lots of great history. There's also an endangered plant that occurs there, which had been observed, then wasn't seen for many, many years, and then the Broadbrook Coalition did a big clearing project right around 1994 or so, something like that. And lo and behold, basically that was a species that needed this photosynthetic input. The sunlight came on. I went in there with another botanist. It was like weedy with this highly at that point endangered sedge. So it's the kind of species though that if you don't maintain and now reduce things like glossy buckthorn or swallowwort, which really the name reveals its behavior, it overwhelms. And so anyway, it's a project That's really important in terms of the context of keeping certain lands open, that site for its historical and wildlife value. But the other piece is that if you look at Fitzgerald Lake, and you just look at only Fitzgerald Lake, most of the Fitzgerald Lake property is free of invasives. It's really restricted to paths, a handful of areas and wetland areas, and then these areas that were historically disturbed. So with BBC, you know, they're targeting those properties. So I can't say enough great things about BBC, and this is a project which they have the opportunity to nail it now, so before it gets much worse. So I can't, it's another one. They're all good. But it's a good one. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Laura. Anybody else for invasives at Fitzgerald Lake? Okay, let's move on to the First Churches and the Stained Glass Restoration Project.
I am Reverend Todd here from First Churches, a senior pastor there. Actually, if it's okay with you, I'd like to go last. I think we have a number of people that like to speak. And that way you can ask questions at that point if you like. I just want to thank all of you who've come to the church to see the windows and the thoroughness that you've had in looking at our proposal. I really, really appreciate that. So is that okay if we do
it? So the proposal go last tonight?
That I go last?
Or that you personally go last?
Yeah, I think we have quite a few people to speak. So maybe I'll hit clean that. But I thought maybe Reverend Peter Ives is here, who is our former pastor, and he has spent more than 20 years working on the building, and I think we had a proposal at the very first CPC when it started, and I thought Peter might start out and share some of his experience as well.
Thank you for letting me speak. The First Church's building is one of the most extraordinary buildings here in Northampton. It was built in 1878, at the same time College Hall was being built at Smith by the architects Peabody and Stern. And so this is truly one of the historical buildings par excellence that we have in this city. And it's also central, I believe, and I feel this extremely, that is central to the vitality of downtown Northampton. It's in many ways the heart of downtown Northampton because of all the people who use the building. It has three worshiping congregations in the building. It has it has 40 different groups that use the building from outside. About 1,200 people come in and out of the building from Northampton. And the lighting of this building at nighttime totally illuminates the downtown in the most beautiful way every single night. The apron is used by all these community groups, including different concerts out in front. And there's many interfaith events in this community that happen at First Churches. The problem that they face is the pressures on their finances. We came to you in 2007 when the entire sanctuary collapsed. All the plaster, all the historical plaster from 1878 fell to the ground, and we ended up having to do the entire sanctuary and the entire roof. And the organ pipes had to be removed and stored in the basement of the building. And there was just a time of enormous reconstruction of the entire sanctuary. And we had to take out a $2 million loan in order to do that from United Bank. And at that time, you helped us too. And the city council voted unanimously to help us with CPA money, which was a real blessing to us at that time. But the pressures on us in that building are just enormous. The organ and the different components of the building, the roof, the steeple, the pressures are enormous on one congregation especially. And that's what's so worrisome about being able to manage the First Church's building. And the loan that we took, the $2 million loan, we fell short about $600,000. And that continues to put pressure on their finances. And so now the stained glass windows in the sanctuary are under pressure too, just from longevity. And one of the most beautiful of all of our stained glass windows is the Tiffany stained glass window that Louis Tiffany did back in 1889. They installed that Tiffany stained glass window in that building right on Center Street. I go regularly to the museum in New York, the Museum of Fine Arts, and they have about six different Tiffany stained glass windows there with the title River of Life, which is one of the most important motifs of Louis Tiffany. And I will tell you, we have probably the most beautiful of those seven River of Life stained glass windows right here in Northampton. It's a real treasure. But there are other stained glass windows too. And I ask you to really consider the enormous pressures that this old historic meeting house with its beautiful stained glass windows is under at this time. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter.
Yes,
Peter.
Okay.
My name is Francie Riddle, and I live at 17 West Center Street in Florence. I was baptized at First Churches when I was a wee babe, and now I'm the parent of a daughter who is participating in the confirmation class of the church, and we go there every week with my mom, so it's a family affair. I'm also an art professor at an area community college. We know there's a historic preservation restriction that requires that we preserve the building into the future, including features like the stained glass windows. You know, the point of those is the Tiffany stained glass window. And it really is in need of restoration. You can't move it, can't sell it, can't do anything with it. We've got to protect it. So, you know, it's kind of our duty to protect that piece of art. First Churches has served the people of Northampton since its founding in 1654 and continues to serve as the meeting house of the community. And our church is asking for the support of the community through CPA funds to help us preserve the stained glass windows. The preservation we are proposing would ensure the safety and the beauty of these windows for the next 100 years, likely four more generations in Northampton. So when my daughter, who is 13, learned of the situation, she wisely and very emphatically stated, "People should take care of their history." I'll try to channel her. "They should not let it go." She was very emphatic about it. It's like, I want to go and talk to this committee. So anyway, I'm here. She's at home. So we really do request your help. Thank you.
Thank you.
So we had a lot of people come. I'm not sure anybody else wants to speak from the church. I think we're just interested to see what would happen. We wanted to show up and be present. We didn't know if there would be people, you know, against the proposal. You've heard from me. We put in an extensive application. You looked at a lot of things. I don't necessarily want to spend a lot of time repeating things you've already heard. Do you have questions? Anything else you want to know from us before we finish up this section?
Are there minutes or other documents that concern the placement of the Tiffany window into that particular portal?
The only real document we've been able to find on that was the original newspaper account that came out in the 1890s. And there was only about a paragraph kind of dealing with the wind, you know, had a lot about who was there and, you know, all that kind of stuff in the paper. But the only thing it really said was it was noting even in that era that the window was dark. And I think that is just how it was designed and what kind of window it is. But as far as the placement,
You know, you think it was actually designed to, in order to be a dark window?
It certainly came out in the original. We think that it'll let in a lot more light. From what we've heard from the restoration folks, it'll let in a lot more light when it's cleaned up, and we'll be able to see it much better. But it is kind of interesting when you look at it as a whole, that sanctuary is really made to be golden light, kind of coming in different seasons, you get light in different sections, and it's meant to be like more of a warm yellow and golden light in there. And so the window's kind of an odd architecture. Some of you have gone in yourself and said, it doesn't quite fit in some ways, but we have it, and there it is. But it is hard to see, in part because the buildings across the street now do block some of the light, so it's a little bit like Stonehenge. You can only see it certain times of the year and things like that. We'll try to have special festivals around the light. We'll dance around it.
You're laughing back there. Somebody visited some cathedrals in Europe and they
have a
coin box there and put the twin lights on.
Yeah. Am I answering the question that you're
asking? Yeah, I guess if the window were to come out completely as a plan, the expectation would be that it would go back into the same portal then.
I thought there was some discussion last time when David was not here about moving it possibly if that were allowable. So is your thinking changed on that? Or?
Well, that was a question to us.
Yeah.
I think we really have to sit down with the stained glass specialist and see if that's even possible.
Sure.
To see, over time, I don't know that those are all exactly the same size, and there may be some real challenges. It may make it very cost prohibitive. But we'll do whatever you'll pay for. if you'd like us to add in the moving costs of switching the windows to our proposal.
That's the thing that MHC would have to weigh in on.
Sure.
I don't think they would necessarily give that a blessing either. So I know that we did discuss it.
Yeah, well, right. We would actually have to ask the state.
Yeah.
And that's certainly under their jurisdiction. And I don't know how much more light we would capture, given how dark it is. We would probably get more light, but I don't know how big the difference is.
It's a very dark window.
Yeah.
Is it darker than the others that Reverend Ives saw? This particular one?
That's a question. Well, it's just its place when the sun, during the season of Advent, when the sun does hit the window, it lights up in the most beautiful of colors. But the trouble is the buildings next door on Center Street and the angle of the sun. But it's absolutely as beautiful as anything down in the Metropolitan Museum when the sunlight is shining right upon it.
Those have the advantage of the rear illumination.
Yes.
In New York.
Yes, exactly.
And just so I'm clear once again, the Tiffany is your top priority. The A10, I can't remember what the name of that window is.
So we often refer to it as the Rose Window, which is in the part of the sanctuary, the end of the sanctuary towards Main Street, and it's kind of a complex of windows that looks like a big star in several sections. So it has the most structural pressure on it, weight bearing wise.
That is C1 on our chart, is that correct?
Yes, that's correct.
Okay, so that's your second.
Yeah.
And then the A10 is the...
So it's the window adjacent to Tiffany, and it's the one that has Jesus on the road to Emmaus, I think. So it's also the other window that has a scene to it. It's not just the colored stained glass.
So again, forgive me for using numbers, but in our chart that you gave us, it would be A3, C1, and A10.
That's correct. Three,
in that order.
Mm-hmm.
Questions? Anybody else to speak on First Churches?
Well, thank you again for your time and consideration. And We understand the pressures that you're under, and you know, I think we picked our numbers just to show you what our need was, and we also understand that we can come back again in other years, and we'll just keep working at it. So thank you.
Thank you. Okay, next up is the Housing for Homeless Youth.
Hi, I'm Rick Hart. I've already appeared before you, so I'm not going to talk a lot about my own project, actually. But if it's okay, I want to support two of the other things that were spoken about. I'm a big natural history buff. I'm a member of Broadbrook. And I think that's a really great project. I feel sort of weird talking, supporting other people's projects. And all the historic projects, in the middle of my career, I was a local history librarian and took care of historic materials, and I think those all sound like great projects, including the curtain set. But especially First Church, I will say, I'm in there a lot. I'm not a member of the church, or any church, actually. But they're so involved with many other things in the community. I'm in there for events. They're major allies of the Friends of the Homeless, and allow us to use their space to store things and have events. So it's a place of the treasure, and it's a beautiful building. Having said that, I just said quickly, I do hope you look on our request as favorably as you can. It is, to me, seems particularly urgent because it's actually young people that are really in need. So I'm just going to let other people speak at this point. I'm also here if you have questions, so thank you.
Hi, my name's Mo McGinnis. I am co-owner with Pete St. Martin of Sylvester's and Roberto's. And we've been in this community for 32 years just as business members. And I'm going to talk about Friends of the Homeless because that's near and dear to my heart. But I also want to say something about the First Church because my kids have grown up there. I've been very much a part of it in multiple ways. And it is what I call the center of Northampton. It's really the center. And when I go to do the shelter at night, there's all that great action going out there. And it's just an amazing organization. And our organization is asking for this incredible opportunity. I've been on the board for 18 years. Not on the board, but involved. I've been doing dinners, and I don't know whether any of you have worked the shelter in Northampton, but it's pretty amazing on Center Street. Every single night from, they run it from November to May, a group of people go in there and make dinner for about anywhere between 24 and 28 people. Sometimes there's more, but they don't stay, they can't stay, so we box up meals for them. But it's all non-denominational, so you have all these groups of churches and synagogues. It's just an amazing group of people. That's how I first got involved. I also like to work on Grove Street, which I go up and give a lot to. That's more of a self-sustaining place. And now, as a board member, we're trying to get this very much needed housing project for youth, and they're really youth that are hand-selected, they're going to go through an evaluation process, but that are homeless. And it's amazing when you look, when you're in the shelter every single month, you see the population change, and right now the need for homeless youth are really pretty incredible, 18 to 25. And a lot of these kids are great kids, you know, they're out on their luck. I always think like a good majority statistically, I believe, are LGBT. And they have no home to go to, but they want to stay in school and they want to work in our community. And so for me, I just want to say that this project is just so in need. I know that we had this meeting at Roberto's where the whole community came to talk about it. I know Dave Sullivan was there. I know he's not here tonight, but you know what the district attorney's dealing with the heroin and opiate increase, and that here we have this opportunity to do this really great project that's possible. and it's only going to impact a small percentage, but it's a great impact. It's going to help these youth that have nothing, no support, and give them support to succeed. And they're going to just give back to this community tenfold. So it's in my heart. Their project's important. Our project's important. You guys have a rough job. But thank you very much for listening. Any questions? Thank you for your time.
Hi. So my name is Michael Trebley. I live at 35 Fruit Street. I'm a tenant of Northampton Housing. I also work for ServiceNet, and I'm the case coordinator of the Hampshire County Homeless Resource Center, right on Center Street, which is also the shelter at night. And I've been there for 15 years since we opened our doors. So I have worked with a lot of homeless youth in that 15 years. In the past few years, there seems to have been an increase in homeless youth. But what I've seen through those years is many of these kids come from the foster care system, which in many ways is broken, because these kids, usually when they turn 18, they have to leave. And a lot of them that are going from home to home to home, they don't have any basic life skills. So when they leave, they're going to the street. And what I see in them is, first, there's a sense of freedom. I'm out in the street, I can do what I want. But you know what happens with most of them is they get into what we call a homeless cycle, and end up, you know, 1 month becomes 6 months, a year, 2 years, and then before you know it, it's their life. And you know, once somebody is in that cycle for a long period of time, it's a very difficult thing to get out. So a house like this would be just an amazing amount of help for, yes, it would be just a few people at a time, but you know, right now, there's nothing in Hampshire County. When I work with the homeless youth, and I work with many of them, and I can't even tell you how many, but it's many over 15 years. They're, you know, Dialed Self, which is going to be partnered with, you know, there's going to be housing, and Dialed Self is going to get services. They have a similar house in Greenfield, so, you know, we would refer people from Hampshire County to Greenfield, but that was usually a big barrier. Because these kids they didn't want to go to Greenfield, or, you know, generally speaking, if somebody was homeless up, if there was a homeless youth in Franklin County, they were probably going to get into that house before someone in Hampshire County. So this project is really needed, and I support it with all my heart. It would, you know, make life easier for everyone, because we, as caseworkers, would be able to refer youth to this house, and hopefully they would, from there, maybe go back to school, then get out in the community, and help other homeless youth. I mean, that's how I look at it. So I had written down a whole bunch of stuff, but I just figured to tell you, you know, and I had a story, if I just, this is a pretty difficult story, just because of homeless use and heroin use. It's the increase has been incredible. And I would say, I don't have statistics, but it's like every other homeless youth that I'm dealing with. This is between the ages of 18 and 22, over the last year and a half. They're addicted to heroin. And it's an explosion. And it's a real serious problem. It's a serious problem for the community. It's a serious problem for them. We had a client 3 weeks ago who passed away. This is a client that I first met at 18, 12 years ago. And he got caught up in this, and he could never get out of it. He was in and out of jail. And he was a really nice kid. But, you know, he OD'd. And so another reason why this house is needed. That's all I got. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Michael McSherry. I live at 66 Fox Farms Road in Florence. I'm also the pastor of Edwards Church. You may have heard of it. We live in the shadow of First Churches. But it's a beautiful shadow. And very well lit at night. but that's not why I'm here. I wish it could be. I work with Mike from time to time. It's a privilege to work with him. Now, we help each other out. I just want to ask you to consider one thing. You have very many, very worthy requests for support. But a society is judged by the care it takes of its most vulnerable members. That's all I want you to think about. Thank you.
Thank you.
Tom Greer, 124 Mosier Street. And I'm on the board of Friends of the Homeless and helping them raise funds for the house. I'm also on the board of the Housing Partnership for Northampton and Valley CDC Real Estate Committee. And if anybody knows any other housing organizations, I can be the board member of. Clearly, I care about this a lot because I spent 8 years managing single adult homelessness for Poughkeepsie, New York, an organization called Hudson River Housing. And we had 125 people a night. And I think what Mike said is so crucial. Because what we found is when we had young adults coming into the general homeless population, they did not thrive. And it was just so difficult to serve their needs. And because we had so many different, you know, in serving the needs of the homeless, it's not like it's just one group of people. There's so many different target groups that need support. People with mental illness and people with substance abuse or just short-term job loss or, you know, all the situations. When we look at youth, especially, needing the stability, some case management and guidance in place to just gather themselves and make that transition into adulthood, it's so important. Our agency at Poughkeepsie had a program like this. We had a large home with about 15 rooms in it that we could place people, and it made such a difference to me to be able to pick up the phone and just say, you know, how soon can we get somebody out of the shelter population or off the street or wherever and get them into a place where they can stay and start to put their life together. And I'd really like Mike and the other social workers to have that chance to make that call. There's a gap in service. In our area, we do not have anything like this that creates this transitional housing opportunity for youth. And so thank you for considering it. I think it's just a crucial niche population that needs to be served in this area.
Thank you. Anyone else for the shelter? Okay. Let's see, moving on to the conservation fund for the Northampton Conservation Commission. Okay. The Williamsburg Whale Trail Connector. Silence. The Sheldon Field Expansion. And last but not least is the Sawmill Hills to Water Edge. I can't remember what that one is.
Acquisition.
Thank you. Yeah. So the Sawmill Hills acquisition. Okay.
In the absence of speakers in those areas, we've covered everything now, right?
Say again?
We've covered all of the.
We have covered all the projects.
Could I just have asked a question of the last
sure
group? I don't know the best answer. What, and forgive my ignorance and forgetfulness. How was this project though for the youth housing that we've maintained over the long term financially?
Oh, sorry, that was about the youth house?
Yeah.
I don't hear you. actually it's an interesting model that we do with that. we just buy the properties. You've done this twice before with CPA Hill, and get them fixed up and ready to go, and then we deed them to an agency to actually manage the program. And we have written into the deeding is affordability restrictions and protocols and all kinds of things about, you know, it has to be used for that purpose. They can't suddenly decide they want to use it for something else. But the actual finances and management, both of the property and the programs at that point, are their responsibilities, and we have an agreement about that too, which is in the packet we gave you. Naturally, we look at, can they actually sustain the programs, because we don't have it just crash and burn. But Dow Self is getting, I think that was also in the attachment, has a pretty well articulated method, because they've already running three houses already up in Quabbin and Franklin County. So they tend to fund the services from government contracts and grants, and the buildings themselves from rents, whether it be subsidized payments of some kind or whatever the source is. And they do also some private fundraising. So they're pretty adept at juggling those different sources to make sure that the thing runs.
And what's the upper end of age?
It's 18 to 24. Actually, it's a little tricky because the statistics are generally done for 18 to 25. So we keep coming up with statistics for the homeless youth that are 18 to 25. But our service population for this particular project is 18 to 24.
And do you anticipate coordinating with the Northampton school system? And many of the students would be eligible until they turn 22.
Yes.
For services from the...
Oh, yeah. Well, any homeless youth... this is really targeted for unaccompanied homeless youth, which is a category where they're not with family at all. And so they generally are, they're doing things like couch surfing or living in cars or on the streets or whatever. But some of them are still managing to be in school. Yes, they would be certainly helpful. We have a contact in the school system that we communicate with. We haven't
been working with them
yet.
Mass rehab?
Mass rehab, I don't know anything about that. That would be probably up to Dow Self.
So they're mandated to provide job
exactly.
Training.
Yeah. I haven't actually asked them that, but I doubt they've missed that opportunity. Yeah.
And what's the anticipated length of stay?
This is technically permanent supportive housing. So there's no cutoff point, like it's just for 3 months, it's just for 6 months. And so are the other two houses we did. So it's not transitional in its formal mm-hmm. thing. What we find is that they really do rotate at a pretty steady rate. As people put their lives together, they tend to want to move on to their own place. It is still a bunch of people living in a house, mm-hmm. even no matter how much we divide it up. So in fact, I don't think in the other two houses, which were 2008 and 2011, as of last year, none of the original people are there anymore. They've all moved on. And from what I hear from Dow Self and other people working in this field, the youth population is even more probably doing that. Because once they get the skills and more structure in their life and they've had some time, they tend to move on to other things. They either go to school or they want to move out with someone or whatever. So Dow Self gave me an average length of time, and I can't remember it, but it was pretty short. So, you know, the house, for instance, on Maple Avenue, the one that's a sober house, it's been open since 2011. It's already had, I think, 22 people in it. It might be more now. I think a couple turned over. So that's a pretty fast turnover. Did that
happen? And you can do placement to Dover, man, to just about any
we won't have anything to do with placement. That's entirely Dow Self.
So please?
We won't have anything to do with the placement.
I mean, of the building itself. I mean, the location of the building itself. Is
oh, that that is still open. Yeah. I will share with you that our best one that we've seen so far, I've heard, has had an offer accepted on it. So that may be off the table. I don't know for sure. That's hearsay. but I just heard that through the grapevine, so I don't know.
Are you eligible for protection of the so-called Dover Amendment, where you can go in and, as an educational institution, fit into almost any neighborhood?
I don't know the answer to that.
Okay. Are there any restrictions on where you can be?
No, I can't.
Good.
I can't imagine it would be.
Good.
Yeah. Anything other than regular zoning restrictions. The houses we look at, we have not so far, and we're not planning this time on massive remodeling or changing the nature of the house. We buy multi-unit houses and we use them. They're used as multi-unit.
Good luck.
Thanks. Yeah. That's a good chance to clarify.
Yeah. Thank you. I know these are old questions for them, but I'm going to catch up. Thank you.
Any other questions? Yeah. Thank you so much.
Okay, why don't we take a few minute break? Okay, let's get going. We have moving into the financial review that Sarah's going to guide us through in terms of how much money we have to spend and also our ability to bond, which I think is of concern to a number of us.
So bottom line number is that we have about $787,000 in cash available for this round. And a few people had asked about bonding, so the bonding capacity tab on the sheet that I sent out shows our current bonding obligations and what we can bond for each year. So that means that our payment for anything that we choose to bond couldn't exceed that amount. So for next fiscal year, we can't make any additional payments more than $222,000.
And that assumes the bond for phase one, bond payments for phase one, they're rolled into the FY17 figure?
They are. And we don't have to make any payments for the last part of this fiscal year. That'll start next fiscal year.
I thought there was some interest that we needed to pay this year?
There was.
Sarah, I'm confused. So we can only bond up to $222,000. Is that correct?
That's what our payment. That's the maximum payment that we could make.
But that doesn't represent the amount we could.
That's not the total.
That's debt service. That's not borrowing.
Yeah.
I got it. Okay. So if in fact we decided to bond something such as Pulaski, we could bond the entire 805. Is that correct?
Yes. It couldn't be done in 2 years, for example, because there's not enough available. But so if you add up the numbers, you can see how far we'd have to extend it. So a 4-year bond would be over $1 million.
Okay. Thank you.
Was Pulaski phase one actually put out yet?
It has not been put out. It's going out to bond before the end of this fiscal year. I think council will vote on it, probably May or June.
How is it not out to bond with all the work going on?
There was enough in other available accounts to do it. And then also once the money is set aside, that money is available to spend in that fiscal year. But we just have to make it balance up before the end of the year. And it gets lumped in with other bonds. The city only does that once a year.
And just so I'm clear, Sarah, the $787,000 available to us, $150,000 of that is set aside for affordable housing. So if in fact we were not to fund any affordable housing, the one affordable housing project, we would then be left with $630,000. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Everyone got that? Yes? Okay. Any other financial questions for Sarah?
Sarah, I thought John was going to work on running some numbers for potential bonding of phase two so that we could see what those options were.
Well, she does that, Brian. Say what you said a minute ago about the categorical set aside and how that changes the amount.
So we have $787,000 total, but $150,000 of that is set aside for affordable housing.
Thank you.
The numbers are on the first tab of the Excel sheet, actually. It's sort of broken out.
Does that help?
Mm-hmm.
So we have $630,905 that's undesignated and $6,871 for historic.
And are people clear? Sarah, did everyone see the letter from Kiki? Or did that just go to you and me?
That just went to us. But that basically just talks about the suggestion to only.
Right.
Only the 2,000.
So are people clear as to what significant change in proposal from 216,000 to perhaps as little as 2,000, which would be the dendrochronology. Dendrochronology. But then also, if in fact, as Devin and Chris and Dave, I think maybe a few people brought up how to do some short-term protection to keep those of us that went there, it's some really open gaps of rain coming in. And my assumption is by the next meeting, Kiki went back to Sarah what perhaps some additional cost would be. But again, significantly less than $216,000.
How would you come to mind that this could be a small grant?
It could.
Okay.
Although we're looking at it.
Not necessarily.
Yes.
Can I ask just a technical question, sir? I hear the 787, and I'm also looking at this spreadsheet that you sent out. Where does that show up?
It's not on the
spreadsheet. It's on
John
Cat. It's a big spreadsheet.
That's just
different.
The bonding portion.
Oh, just for bonding,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, there's multiple tabs here. It defaults to that sheet when you open the bond.
That's
great. Other financial questions? For Sarah?
Yeah, so some of it we can, if people are just wondering how much the payments would be bonding for certain amounts for certain years, I have a spreadsheet that can spit that out immediately.
Yes, exactly.
Okay.
And the phase one numbers are based on an assumed 2% interest rate, is that right, in 5 years?
Yes.
Does that still seem good, the 2%?
It's we don't know exactly, but it'll be like someplace in that ballpark.
We bonded phase one for 5 years?
I think that's what we asked for.
Yes. $1,330,000 over 5 years.
What, I'm sorry, 1 million
three?
330.
330
over 5 years. Anything else? Are we still waiting for you to get? Did Sarah answer all your questions, Linda? No.
No, she's got something that you're going to print out.
I'll email it around because it's sort of interactive.
We have between 2 and 3. Until 2022, we have about between $200,000 and $300,000, right? In amount available to bond. So if they're asking for it.
Right, but we don't know what other projects may come along that we might want to bond for. So that
right, but Sarah's not going to be able to.
No.
What is that? Either.
Yeah, and what's not shown here, which we can put together, is what it. Sort of the opportunity cost of bonding, how much will that reduce our funding available for future rounds?
Right.
So I can do that.
That would be really helpful. Thank you. Any other financial questions for Sarah?
I'd just like to go on the record and say I hate bonding. Because I think ties us up for the future. And there is an expense of paying on the debt that if you could just meter out those projects in a way that doesn't have to go into debt to do them, you were spending more money on the projects themselves.
The same way when I bought my house and had to take out that new mortgage.
For certain projects, I would agree. On other projects, construction projects, if you wait, you're going to pay 10% more doing it 3 years later. The 2% is an amazing rate that you can't get it in construction. For something like stained glass, I don't know what the escalation rate of stained glass restoration is, but it's a different story. does seem like a famous thing, but that might be a good decision.
Well, we did it for Grow Food, you know, for the
Florence Fields.
Florence Fields. I mean, we've done it for, you know, big projects because that's the only way we can do them.
Right. I mean, I think as we start to weigh projects against each other, it's important to think about if it's worth it to bond for one project just so we can fund this year a project that it wouldn't be worth to bond for, then we're sort of bonding for that project that it's not worth to bond for in a way. In other words, if we're putting money into the preservation fund so they can have money to play with, we're basically bonding that money, even though it might not be there on the spreadsheet.
Yeah.
So.
Okay, it is 8:15. How do we want to proceed? Do we want to say we'll spend 45 minutes beginning our funding recommendations and go to 9? We could call it a night and not begin funding recommendations at all. I don't think we have other, is there any other business not foreseen?
No.
Nothing?
Nothing.
Okay. So how do folks want to proceed here? Yeah.
It would be helpful to me to have just a general understanding of how you guys have moved forward from this point in the past.
Okay.
Do you go program by program or whatever, anything?
I think one of the problems with the age of this committee is no one can really remember.
All right, I'll read some old minutes.
Go read some old minutes. Don't ask questions like that. So what we've done, so let me start and then people help me out here. How about that? So we have this sort of concept of the shopping cart, like when you go to the, you know, shop online and you can put things in the shopping cart, but we're sort of, yeah, you know, that looks interesting, yeah, but we're not holding ourselves to it. And I think that's worked reasonably well, is that we begin discussion with each proposal. Do we want it in the cart or do we want it out? And in fact, some proposals we may agree that we just don't, we're pretty unanimous and that we don't want to consider. Or that we want to really look at partial funding or that we really want full funding. So we have sort of an initial exploratory session in discussing each of the proposals as they have come in. Questions that we have, we can put them in then in the shopping cart at a certain amount, and then all of this is to be revisited at a second go-round where we begin to really solidify what that is given what our fiscal constraints are. Sarah has passed out to all of us this, and I think she sent it online as well, this spreadsheet, and I don't think any of us have done it, but perhaps this would be helpful once we begin this discussion this evening for us to go through with a fund fully, partially, or do not fund, rank the different projects, and then put comments down as well. Because again, that can help us clarify where the group consensus is or is not on these projects. So I think ideally we could start tonight and maybe even finish the next meeting. We have another meeting tentatively set for the continuation of this, which is the first Wednesday in May.
Yes, because generally conditions and fine tooth stuff sort of gets lost at the end, so we add another meeting.
Correct.
So
I think there are a couple things that we've struggled with. One is having an initial conversation, going through all the proposals, and then when we meet 2 weeks later, remembering what that initial conversation was, and I'm being serious here, and not going through the same stuff as we just did. So that's important. The second thing that I know I've struggled with is waiting to the end of the final meeting evening to begin to set conditions on proposals. And we're exhausted, and some of us are grumpy, and the socks are playing, and so I think perhaps as we go this, particularly with this maybe initial discussion, as we go through proposals, if there are specific conditions that we want to move forward for those proposals, then we do that at that time, rather than waiting to the end when we're just really pretty fried, or at least I'm pretty fried. So can I move that we go till 9 o'clock? Is that okay?
Yeah.
That gives us 40 minutes?
Yeah, that's good.
Okay.
Could I suggest that we just in one procedure would be, I think we've done this in the past, and just sort of go down the list, spend maybe 5 minutes talking about each one.
Sure. What, should we go in order of the sheet that Sarah gave us?
Sure. And if anybody has any particular knowledge or sponsorship or ownership or anything, speak up. And that will at least begin to help us figure out which of these we want to have in the shopping bag at all.
Great. Let's do that. It was a little disconcerting to me to find the first 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 with no one here. It's like, really?
I could have gotten up and spoken about the conservation.
That's true, but that's kind of weird.
Yeah, that's right.
So let's begin with Sawmill Hills Open Space Acquisition. One, general comments or questions people have?
I'll just say generally, I think the four have various levels of greatness to them, I think they did a great job prioritizing them. Actually, do we have any record of what that priority was? Because I have my memory of what the priority that he had said it was.
Sawmills was the top.
Yeah,
I think it was Sawmill.
Jack recounted that it was Conservation Commission's top one.
Yeah.
Then Sheldon after that, and Conservation, and I think he said that
Rails Trail was last.
Rails Trail could wait.
He was blunt that it could come next
time.
And
Sawmills could wait?
No, Sawmill was number one.
Number one, okay.
Yeah, but Rail Trail could wait at least another cycle. And he hedged Sheldon, I would say.
Yeah.
I wouldn't say Sheldon was clear number two for him. It was a really hedged number two, as in, well, sure, Parks and Rec, and we are really interested in that. And there might be another way to fund that, too.
And I actually have conservation listed as number two, so.
Yes, I do.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
He was deferential to the idea that, okay, that's another group, and I should, possibly move that one up, because that would be their number one. Yeah.
I don't know what the history of the conservation funding, the funding of the conservation fund, this group
well,
is.
Well, the issue with there is that Wayne periodically has.
No, I understand what the function of it is. I just, the history of how much we funded, this body has funded over the years, and it just seems to be a strange, considering the amount of review that every other project goes through, to give someone sort of unrestricted funds like that, even if it's for very good reason, it seems very odd, considering how much people have to, justify, $12,000 for invasive species.
Sarah, you want to speak to that?
I don't have any history.
There is a tab on the spreadsheet which shows you all the times that money's been allocated to conservation fund.
Well, I guess I'm the history of the conversation about it.
It's really fun to do when we have extra.
Right.
Okay. Well, the thing about it is that often in the conservation kind of work, there's a lot of things that have to be taken on short supply. You can't really go through the process because the landowner is, or the transfer of the deed, or it's on the ground, the work on the ground has to be done in a timely way. And sometimes they can involve, like, land trust organizations are built up around to do some of that work, but with some of these things that are specific to the Northampton conservation planning, it's not always possible to get the land trusts and those people to mobilize quick enough.
I mean, I think the point well taken, because there are times we worry about whether how much this beam is going to cost versus that beam, or we get into some detailed discussion sometimes, and then we turn around and hand Wayne, $80,000 for a land trust here and there, and so I understand the point entirely. But as Jack says, Wayne has also made good defensive quantity that's been necessary in the past.
I mean, I think it's for things like an $800 survey that if you didn't have that, you wouldn't get the you wouldn't get the land transacted. So I'm not really worried about it. I do think I don't want too much money sitting here, but I want some.
Right. No, it just seems it's an outlier.
Yeah.
Just philosophically, I suppose.
And I think, Dave, we generally have funded it so they have some money. It's down now to pretty much zero, correct? It's at a few hundred, under $1,000.
Okay.
If that is in fact true, when was the last time, and maybe you have this in front of you, when was the last time they got an injection? I mean, how long did how much last? I guess is what I'm asking.
The last one was $20,000 made this time last year, and it's gone.
But it depends on what's going on as to how long it lasts.
Right.
Sometimes a smaller amount will last longer.
Yeah, no, I understand.
Things in the hopper at the moment.
I have one question. I think I know the answer, but regarding open space acquisition, I've been involved a lot in some of the anti-pipeline work that I think everyone's familiar with that's going on in Western Massachusetts. And something that's a great concern to me is this court issue that's going on now. I think maybe everyone knows about it, which is Article 97 of the Mass Constitution, which says conservation restrictions can only be overruled with a two-thirds majority of both the State House and the State Senate. Yet Kinder Morgan is looking to FERC to overrule that entirely and be able to put pipelines through conservation areas, no matter, and really running, in my opinion, roughshod over the our state constitution. Is there anything, Sarah, that goes above and beyond a conservation restriction? Now, the chance of a pipeline going in this sawmills acquisition, I suppose.
Yeah, but other issues come up. As I understand it, that's only with Article 97, but that particular property that's under question doesn't have a conservation restriction. So a conservation restriction is over and above Article 97. I mean, it would involve Kestrel Land Trust getting into a, or whoever holds the CR getting into a legal debate, potentially with FERC and utility companies. But
right.
But
is there anything above and beyond? I mean, can we put on a condition that specifically states that there will be no gross intrusion, such as a fossil fuel infrastructure coming through? I mean, or is that implied in a conservation restriction?
I mean, a general conservation restriction would protect against that anyway, but you can amend it as needed. So you could add some condition that the conservation restriction must specifically state something that would be allowed.
Okay.
If you're trying to prevent Kinder Morgan from coming through, I don't know that would have any greater legal impact.
Right, that's my question. Yeah, yes.
I mean, somebody owns the property and, you know, they're threatening to come through and take it by eminent domain, so you can certainly come and take a conservation restriction. Supporting it, I'm just
right.
saying if their preemption and the public
right.
mortgage and all of that are upheld.
Yeah.
And since this is a general comment on any land that is under conservation,
yes.
by any city.
Yeah. Because I guess my point is I would like to see the greatest amount of restrictions placed on anything that we are putting aside. And if there's something that we can go beyond a conservation restriction, and we can't set conditions on every imaginable, foreseeable technology coming in the future, but if there was something else, Rich?
The location of the land made me curious as to whether or not it's considered part of the watershed, and if that is in fact true, whether or not that implies anything else. Certainly you don't want to run a fuel pipeline through your water supply.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So,
subdivided and gave
yeah.
us the map, and so that would say it's probably not watershed because there's already consideration for some type of
I can't imagine that it's not, but the only
yeah, I know it's
yeah.
right next to the Roosevelt.
Yeah, but it could be that until it enters public, you know.
Yeah, yeah. Right.
Get, you know what I'm saying? Because I know
yeah.
that from my brief time on the BPW, whenever watershed land came up, the city was anxious to get a hold of it. But there's no eminent domain or anything like that, so it's acquired as, you know, property.
And this is emergency water, correct? Where
yeah.
this is.
Water, yeah. That's
so it's not our regular water, but
yeah.
it could be used in the case.
And I don't know enough about watersheds to know if that's treated differently or not.
Mm-hmm.
The Northampton watershed is big. It's really big. We only know about a third of it.
As far as development potential goes, the watershed is about half of the property, not all of it. So that prevents it from being an even bigger subdivision. But those three homes are outside of the watershed area.
So anyhow, Brian, that's your homework.
I was going to throw that over to Jack as our conservation commission person.
Well, as far as I know, there's it could end up at the Supreme Court with some of these things, but there are laws for fuel. There's a gas law that federal government has ability to override state and local restrictions for gas distribution. So I think there's probably something in the books. Now, it doesn't mean it can't be challenged, but it could end up at the Supreme Court.
But what you're saying is the federal government's interest isn't to protect, it's probably a national security
thing
that they can go anywhere they want.
An infrastructure protection from distribution.
I don't know that there's many test cases going on very currently in Massachusetts, and that we're better served on debating some of the other merits of some of the other cases on the table. And some of these questions will be resolved for us by some of the ongoing current events.
So, anything else about the sawmill pills? What?
Other than that, I hike that area, and I think it is a pretty, it really completes that area.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I'm up there every day.
I hate to see that be lost.
And it does seem to me, correct me if I'm wrong, that this was Wayne's clear number one.
Oh, yeah.
It really was clear. Like, here's sawmill. Yeah.
Other than Pulaski.
So, anything else about sawmill? Should we just move on? Do we want to take a little straw poll? How do we want to do this?
So, could we maybe have conversations simultaneously? And this is a great moment to say, maybe we don't want to rank and we could keep moving, but could we, in this moment, at least entertain any conversation about full versus partial funding?
Sure.
I feel like that would also help our thinking as we leave.
Yeah.
So, if there was conversation about partial funding, which I'm not sure that really fits with this particular element, but for the others.
Yeah, just to frame the whole conversation.
Exactly.
I'd like to get a sense from everyone, what are the things that they feel most strongly, yay or nay, really, just about every. So I'm more concerned that we get through everything to some degree rather than we just hear about down the list. Because there's some big numbers that knock everything else out.
Right.
Understand what people think about those things.
Well, we could go around and have people give us their top priorities. Would that be helpful?
Yeah, I'm not sure I've prioritized this yet, and
let's just keep going.
Right.
I think, as I said,
it just would be helpful if we were talking about a project and somebody could say, you know, on that one, the way I look at it, I think it could really be a partial. That would be helpful to have that conversation.
Yes. Brian, do you maybe want to ask whether there's anybody who feels strongly against this funding?
Yeah, let's do that. Back to Julia's question, I mean, I see this as a $72,000 proposal without any partial funding. Is that how everyone else
Yes.
Okay. And so the question is anyone really opposed to this? Does anyone have really, was that what you asked?
Yes.
Like?
Yeah.
I'm getting the sense that most of us are, or all of us are supportive. Is that correct on this? And if we're supportive, we're looking at full funding of this. So while we're not really doing this yet, we're sort of tentatively placing this in our shopping cart at funding fully. Moving right down the list, Sheldon Field expansion.
So I have to say the one thing that impressed me was the conversation, or when Wayne was talking about the idea of being able to use this field in trade to gain access to another area. And I know you talked about Rainbow Beach, which is a really desirable area, and right now, to get to Rainbow Beach, you actually have to walk through farmed property, which you're not supposed to walk through, so I'm not saying I've ever done it. Or the other way to get to Rainbow Beach, the way that many other people access it, is from the river directly. So you have to come in by boat. And it is an amazing area that is not accessible to Northampton. And what he talked about with Sheldon Field was this trade opportunity. Farm Sheldon, let's get access to Rainbow Beach. I think that's a great opportunity. We don't have a lot of beach access on the river from our city.
Rich?
I remember that conversation. I mean, the idea of a use swap is intriguing to me. The problem I have with that, maybe this is where, because I wasn't really there when we were having the conversation, maybe this is where the conditional portion of it is, because I don't know that acquiring that land guarantees us access to anything.
That is true.
Yep, so.
Right. You still have to make the trade.
Right.
It just sets up the trade.
Right.
And so that would be a condition.
And I mean, it's all well and good, but if it's just being dangled out there.
Yeah.
But can that be formalized?
Do you know anything more about that? Because it sounded pretty speculative to me. But maybe there's more to it.
Yeah, and there's a lot of talking about it, but nobody's definitely said that would absolutely work for them. The most interested farmer was offering a piece that really didn't provide the access that the city needed, unfortunately. But it's a long discussion.
So if this were to be conditionally funded,
I don't think it would be possible, because until the city can say we absolutely have this property, no, I don't think a farmer would be willing to commit. So sort of
I don't have a player. I can't trade him.
All right. Well, you can trade a player to be named later.
Yeah, right.
Because
you can't
say,
I'm going to get you Tony Dorsett, but I got to buy him first.
Yeah. Only a baseball you're allowed to do it. To me, this, leaving aside the issues on the conservation fund, this to me seems clearly like the least direct benefit to the public. I mean, it's very clearly a long term, which may be quite beneficial in the long term, but in terms of what does the public get out of it, nobody really.
Yeah, and I wasn't convinced that this opportunity was going to go away like some others. Right. There's a possibility. Never know for sure, but it could be hanging around for another year or so.
Yeah.
Well, I agree with that though, because it is an odd parcel.
Yeah.
It's basically someone's backyard.
Yeah.
And I know that you said people want to enlarge their backyards. The people that I know that who live down there, they're trying to find ways to lease their backyards. There's a lot of people with big backyards down there. You can't build both of them. So I don't know if it sounds critical.
No, I agree.
Yeah.
I don't know why someone would want to.
Well, they can do it, but they can't do it legally, right? I mean, you can mow it whatever part of your lawn you want.
Yeah,
it doesn't make it yours.
Right, yeah, I don't know why you would want to just have a bigger one.
Other comments on Sheldon Field?
So we're, this one out of the shopping cart?
I'm detecting we're not, no one is putting it in the shopping cart, are we? Is there anyone? Julia,
yeah, I mean, it's shelved. It has, it's still fresh fruit, but it's shelved.
Okay. So we're looking at it as we walk down the aisle. But we're and Julia sort of made a motion to reach, but has pulled her hand back to the handle.
If you talk about the rail trail, I'll tell you what kind of fruit that is.
Okay.
Okay. So Sheldon Field, right now, we have sort of a tentative out of the cart. Mm. Correct?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Norwood? Julia, want to start with that?
Well, I think the question to Wayne of rank these things and tell us what's most important, tell us what you need, was such a revealing question. This will be important. It is not important now, necessarily. And given the restriction we have on funding things, we have to see it that way. Even though we'd love to see that rail all connected up.
It sounds like even if we fund it next, it's the same timing of actually getting it done, and it's funded next time. It's a great project.
Rich?
Oh, well, I mean, the access is there. It's not going to go away.
That's true.
You know, that was the question I had, which was, I heard that that people don't want you going through there. He assured us that access isn't the issue. You know, you can ride your bike on it. It's just a little bumpy.
Cyclocross bikes.
That's right.
Mountain bikes.
Right.
Sorry, road bike people.
Walking your bike. It's not that far.
Yeah.
You can jog.
You can run, right? Dave? Yeah, I have a question for you and Sharon. So that I know how judicious I have to be with some of these. We have either $787,000 or $630,000 to spend, depending on whether, I guess, if we look at the housing for homeless youth as a long-term housing feature.
Correct.
And that easily, if we were to bond the second section of Wasey Park, then all of these seem to come in rather neatly under the figure of our budget. If we bond Pulaski Park, I'm not saying that we're in hardship here. Is that?
Well, we have 1.9 million in requests. If we took away 200 plus from Shepherd,
Pulaski Park, yeah.
If we take, let's say, a million away, which is Pulaski and Shepherd Barn, or a million.
What I did was I took out Pulaski. I reduced conservation 40k from 80. They took Shepherd down to 2,000.
Sounds like we're getting ahead of ourselves a little bit.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I'm not disagreeing with what you're saying. It just sounds like that's a conversation to come after we've talked about
each individual.
Do you want to talk about this now?
Well, I mean, I'm agreeing with your logic. I just feel like I'll keep it short.
I just wanted to, the reason I'm asking now, rather than after we finish this, is just because we are limited. Traditionally, we've woven this through. We basically want to see how rich are we, how poor are we, and as we go through, because that depends on what you know, depending on how flush you're feeling, that affects what you keep in or take out of your shopping cart. And I guess taking stock of our bonding capacity, and then looking at the reduction of Shepherd Barn and a potential reduction of Shelton Field and Conservation Fund, we're going to be coming in fairly sweetly.
So I think the answer is yes. If we take those two out and reduce a few others, we could be close.
Mm-hmm. And so that means that impact how long we have to spend on this process too.
Yes.
Well, my feeling is if we first do the judicious part of qualifying these things, and then we might have to bond less than we, instead of just, you know, saying, oh, we got enough money, let's spend it all. I'd rather say, let's look at all of these critically, mm-hmm. and then if we get to bond less, that's even better. So,
mm-hmm. that's, and rather than that's thinking that it's worth bonding for the project we're bonding, every project that we're approving needs to be worth the bonding, because any project that didn't get approved is that much less that you would have to bond. Mm-hmm. So
that's a good way to look at it.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah, I agree.
So I'm hearing, that's going back to the Norwalk Rail Trail, that there's no one throwing that in the shopping cart. Is that correct?
No one
is putting the Norwalk Rail Trail into the shopping cart. We're taking that off.
No, I'd like to have it in.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. That's my shopping cart.
Okay. So we got really David sticking up for that, and the rest of us are...
Taking it out.
Anybody else for keeping it in at this point?
It's going to be in the next round.
Yeah. Anyone else for keeping?
It doesn't need to be funded now.
Anyone else for keeping Norwalk in?
The reason I would favor keeping it in is that there are erosion control issues that are degrading the trail for as long as we don't fund it, and it will be mitigated once the funding does happen.
It was pretty clear when he came that whether we fund it now or next round, the work's going to happen at the same time.
Yeah.
It's going to happen next year sometime, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Because they won't hear until September on whether they'll get the grant, so they can't do the work now anyway.
And on the I'm not an engineer, but on the erosion issue, I walk that thing a couple times a week, mm-hmm. and the amount of work they did on the extension in the last year completely changed the landscape there. I'm sure I know a couple places where there are little bits of washing out going on, but I mean, that they re-engineered the whole, they built a new bridge. So I don't see a year's worth, you know, absent that 100-year storm, I don't see mm-hmm. a year's worth of damage being that big.
So David's concerns notwithstanding, we seem to have at least seven of us opposed to putting this in the shopping cart. But again, we will revisit this stuff. The conservation fund is next.
I'd be in for another 20.
I'll see that and raise it to 50.
So 20, 50. 40.
Can we just say partial at this point?
I feel very inclined toward partial.
Agreed. Is anyone in favor of fully funding? Is anyone in favor of do not fund at all? Well, that's a pretty strong partial, and we will revisit that. Can we do that?
Yeah.
Okay. So correct me if I'm wrong, Sawmill Hills, we're totally in. Sheldon Field, we've thrown out. Or Water Rail Trail, we've pretty much thrown out. Conservation Commission Fund, we're partial. Can we just bypass Pulaski Park just for the moment?
I have one comment on Pulaski, and this has to do with the fact that they broke out phase two from this thing about the Academy of Music. And I'm glad they did that, because I think the Academy of Music is also here asking for money. And they're not asking for money for their loading dock. I mean, they're asking for money for a historic preservation thing. I don't see this loading dock. I mean, as long as they're breaking it out, it doesn't seem to fall anywhere near what the CPA funding should be for. Now, I'm willing to be convinced otherwise, but just because something is adjoining a very clear public park doesn't mean it necessarily is in public domain.
I would be the first one here to tell you that that was brought to their attention on the first round, because I had concerns then about the sidewalk and the parking. Mm-hmm. So I don't know how it hadn't gotten considered yet. Mm-hmm.
So let's hold that thought, if we can, and we will get back to Pulaski. The BBC invasives?
Yes.
Anybody opposed to that? Fully fund into the card?
I'm gonna reserve judgment and see where we are.
Okay.
I have higher priorities further down the list.
Okay. Anybody else reserving priorities, or all of the rest of us in for a full amount? Yes? Okay, so Rich, you may be overruled on that, but we'll put all in except for...
Well, and that's a three-year amount.
Three-year project, right?
Right.
Okay. Yeah.
All right.
Does that change your feeling at all?
A little bit.
Peer pressure. So we're sort of fully funding with one concern and thinking.
Shepherd. 2 years, but the big allocation is that first year, right? It's like 50% goes in the first year, and then everything else teemingly drips. So it's a lot of first year money.
So Shepherd Barn, I'm still a little confused. I mean, we're bringing it down to 2,000, but maybe more, contingent on what Kiki gets to Sarah.
I mean, it still seems like a partial fund, so if we just were Xing columns without putting numbers, it's partial fund. Right?
For a partial fund? Significantly partial. So I mean, the request has come down. We're looking at two to maybe a few, right? It didn't seem like it would be more than that. Mm-hmm. And so in fact, it may be funding fully if in fact that's what they've come. But I think most of us are supportive of that. Is that the feeling that I'm getting?
Of the 2,000 thing, or two plus.
Yeah, I'm assuming Kiki will get back shortly, but she will, and Sarah will share that with us.
Just informationally, Sarah, do you have any idea what underlay that? I mean, I was very glad to hear that, but do you know what led to this change in their
I think they just realized, wow, there's a lot of requests, and we'd rather just be able to get this done at this point, so let's just approach it that way.
The other part was, when we were there 3 weeks ago, they brought up the construction schedule, and they can't do it this year. They can't. They need a whole season. They can't start it this summer and carry it over in the winter. So they need to start next spring and carry it through themselves. I think that gave them.
I think it was an April 1st start.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
They have a lot of things going on.
Yeah. That's I'm really glad to see that they have some leadership. I think whatever we say to them, I think it's important to communicate some kind of message that there seems to be not, maybe they have some ideas, but there was not a lot of communication of any ideas of what is the goal for this. I mean, there's a lot of buildings in Northampton that can be preserved. They're very interesting in a lot of ways. There's a lot of barns in Western Penn. You know, there's a lot, not to say anything bad about this building, it's a fantastic building. I think it's very important for an organization like that to have some kind of master plan. What is the purpose? Who are they? What is this place going to be used for? And it sounds like they're moving that way, and they just didn't have anything to say at that moment because of their new leadership. So I think that should be encouraged to be part of their application when they come back.
And it certainly makes sense to have that leadership, have that discussion before they come back to us for funding. And they come on May 1st, is that correct? Lori, and what's the other woman's name? Do you remember?
Betty.
That sounds like they're already thinking about it.
So. And for new folks, we are so concerned, a number of us, that when Nancy left, the whole thing would just crumble. And now they see that these two outstanding women coming on that are just bringing like both sides of the picture. I mean, it's really pretty spectacular.
Well, and the programming's up, and they're on the side of town with the Center for the Arts, and that whole synergy that's going to happen there is very important.
It really is.
That's a way of giving a message that we are encouraging them, and we'd love for them to think like that. So.
And we can certainly say that in funding, if in fact we decide to fund this couple thousand, that if they come back, we want a vision statement of what they're going to do with the barn, if in fact it makes sense to do something.
I was really pleased to hear Lori say that they were going to be looking at their priorities, because I think we kept asking about that. You know, we keep giving you money because it's urgent, it's desperate. What are your, you know, how do we have confidence that you really sculpt it out and that we're applying the money where it's most needed? And I have a sense that there's sort of a calmer approach perhaps could be taken and that it will be thoughtful.
It's the nature of old buildings that they're always going to need money that will always take away from big master plan thinking, which needs to happen as a public institution.
Great, good. Okay, so moving on to the First Church's windows.
Partially.
Mm.
103 comes to mind.
Yeah, that's what I wrote down.
Why? Oh, is that A,
B, and C? That takes care of the first priority window, and I think, you know, it's very easy to put that proposal in next year, and, you know, I think we'll get to them, but that's a great start.
That's just the Tiffany window? That's the number?
Yeah.
You know, as someone not religiously inclined, I did my own site visit in an afternoon, and the sun was shining in, and it was like, oh my goodness, this is really a spectacular place. Mm-hmm. I've been there a lot, but
they do that on purpose, you know.
Well, the light. I mean, I don't.
It's Tiffany, man.
The problem is Brian's only been there at night.
Partial funding, yes. We're all good to go on that. Okay, so two more, and I think we can get through those, right? I can't really see the clock. And then we'll have a little recap and get out of here close to nine. Academy of Music, Kurt. Well, I'll start. So the last time we didn't fund, I did not do the site visit, and this time I did. And I think a number of us that were there said the same thing. You sort of have to see it to appreciate it, or not appreciate it. But being there, I thought, was really pretty dramatic. I mean, it is a really interesting piece of art and history, and the fact that it's a Northampton scene. I was, before I saw it, I was like, come on. But showing up and seeing it in all its grandeur for what it is, it's a pretty interesting piece of art and history. And I think this seems to me to one that we do it or we don't. I'm not sure that we fund part of it. I think the Academy is stretched to, with their capital campaigns, to keep themselves going. I mean, maybe we could do it, you know, a little bit less, but I think this to me anyway is we do it or we don't.
I'm similarly struck by the fact that in person, wow, you know, what a thing it is. And I've been showing people the photos on my phone in the past few weeks, and they're like, oh, that's very cool. It doesn't, even on the picture, it doesn't come up. And then my cousin was here from Texas playing in a show that was there the other night, so I got to go with him to soundcheck. And I was saying, oh, this is an amazing thing, you know. But, you know, it's up, and he, you know, he was there back, so he can't see it. And just the very fact that you have to see it to appreciate it is part of the problem, and I don't think they have much of a plan for really, I think most people will never see it still. And I think that's, I still think it's an amazing thing that should be restored, and at some point it's just gonna fall off and it'll be gone, and it should be fixed. But I'm kind of dismayed that they don't have a better, I don't know what that strategy would be. Maybe that's why they don't have one, but a strategy for really letting people see it. It's a fantastic thing.
And my understanding is the current strategy is once a month, they have the tour. The tour is limited to 20 people. 12 times 20 is not that many people.
Right.
So it's...
Plus appropriate, some appropriate performances.
Correct.
Right.
Do we see this as a fund fully or do not fund?
I would love to have seen it as a series of bids. In other words, I'm not sure that I know that this is the exact amount that it costs. I mean, I don't know how many organizations do this kind of work, but I think the Academy found somebody, they got a price, it includes, you know, I'm missing a confidence in the bid itself, but I don't see any way to do a partial. So some sort of hesitancy about that business arrangement. It's not coming across to me as we looked at three different bidders. There's only four in the country that do it. We've talked to three of them. We got within 20, you know, within a range, and we picked the closest one. And I don't get any of that.
Is it appropriate to, at this late stage, to throw this back to you, Sarah, to ask, what's her name, Judith?
Deborah.
And say, did you go out to bid, and are there other places? I mean, is that, we could do this, right?
Sure. And it would have to meet the city's procurement requirements, but since it's so specialized, they may have already done that. But
so
I,
can
I
you ask that question and have that, or ask her to get that answer to us by the next meeting?
I was swayed by Kiki's comments about, you know, the mill on it, the uniqueness of it. But I'm like you, I wish we knew what was going to happen to it because, you know, it hid back there for decades.
We've heard it tonight that she's a theater professor at Smith that's so integral to the history of Smith, which is so much about landscaping. There could be more of a creative thinking about it. But that said, you can't do anything with it once it falls off. So.
Well, to me, sometimes the compelling argument for a proposal is the urgency of it. You know, if you don't do the invasive, you don't do the land purchase, you know, it's gone, or your barn falls down or something. And I think this is one of those cases where we either act or we don't act. We either say we're going to lose the curtain or some other, because it does seem like there's an immediacy to this proposal. We put it off for a cycle, but it seems like we have to either step up or
some of the, just when we went on the site visit, she was talking about how they reached out to the Textile Museum in Washington, and I happened to, my graduate school thesis professor, I happened to be the architect who designed the Textile Museum when they got their new building, and so I happen to know a lot about their technical capabilities. I think they'd be very hard to find three bidders for some work so specialized. It's just it's not out there. There's artists. So.
And what's a better name than Curtains Without Borders? I mean, come on. Let's go with the name. So where are we on the curtain? Are we half in the car and half out? Unclear, should we leave this one hanging?
I'm in the cart.
In the cart.
We can have it in there and then later on the blanket.
We can.
Yeah, stays.
Yeah.
I wouldn't throw it out.
Okay.
It's not as solidly in as some others.
Okay, but we're putting it in the cart? Is that what we're hearing? Devin, are you in the cart?
Yes. Joy in your heart.
And we're funding fully or not at all, so at this point we're funding fully, correct?
Yeah.
I just
left that. That's right. Just the seal of Northampton.
I couldn't
even see it.
I just
want
to cut the board off the bottom. That's
okay, last on our list is that Housing for Homeless Youth.
And then Pulaski.
Oh, right. Maybe we could have the Housing for Homeless Youth and then
If it's okay with everybody, I would like to delay Pulaski until I can play with the numbers a little bit with Sarah's.
How does that sound? We deal with homeless youth and not deal with Pulaski tonight?
Yes.
Okay. So Housing for Homeless Youth.
I support that.
As do I.
Yeah.
Okay.
The logic notwithstanding, we have to set aside 150 if we don't fund it, so.
It's the most compelling project in the whole group, I think.
Agreed.
Yeah.
Is there anyone for not funding Fuller? Okay, so at this point, my list has us fully funding Sawmills, not funding at all Sheldon Fields or the railroad connector, partially funding the conservation funding, fund Plasky Parks up for grabs, Broadbrook funding fully, Shepherd Barn is weird, funding partially but very partially, First Church Windows partially, Academy Music full, and Housing for Homeless Youth full. Mm-hmm. Is that correct? Mm-hmm. Yeah?
What did you have on the Academy?
We had fully fund.
Yeah.
So we have 4 fully fund, we have 3 partially fund, we have 2 do not fund, and then we have Plasky, which we will figure out at a later date.
My understanding too is this is a work in progress.
Of course.
And that we can come back to these if we find
them. Oh, yes, yes. There have been no proposals made on the table at all.
So generally we use the rankings as a basis to frame the discussion for next time. So if you're ready to give these to me today, then go ahead. If you want to take it home and add some stuff, then it's just any time before the next meeting, even if it's the day before.
And I called Sarah today because I thought I was delayed. I hadn't done this. We've done them either before we start this discussion or now we're doing it in the middle of the discussion. So if anyone has an opinion about whether that works better one way or another, I thought I was behind the power curve, but.
Never.
Never.
You're always ahead.
Not really.
I have to say, I think this preliminary discussion is very helpful for now walking out and doing the ranking.
Okay.
Great.
Good.
Before we leave, just
under Brian's trusted leadership, we did that one.
Is there any? We sort of went through and then didn't talk about conditions at all. Is there any that leap out at us that we can at least be thinking about for any of these?
I would be inclined to give Historic Northampton more than $2,000 if they would put some of that money towards doing master plan. I don't know how that works with, they didn't apply for that. That's, I don't know how that would work.
Yeah, depending on the details, that might not be
able to work.
Yeah.
Put it next time.
Yeah, I had jotted down $16,000 just because I wanted to seal the building and stabilize it. And that is giving us so much leeway to deal with the other projects that I thought that would be well spent. I understand you can't partially fix it, but I'm hoping that that tonight's conversation spurs more than $2,000, but not much more is my hope.
I think, David, in the conversation that we or Sarah has with them, we can state, if you're going to come back to us with another proposal for fully funding, that we want a master plan to be part of that. And we will be less inclined, some of us will be less inclined to consider without that master plan. Rather than funding now, that's an option, is to make it clear that if you're going to come back, we want this in place. And they'll have had May, June, July, August, at least 4 months as co-executive directors to at least begin that process.
I mean, I get the feeling that they want to do that. I'm just trying to think of a mechanism that we would actually support them in that.
Yes, and that's one.
Yeah.
Yeah. Any other conditions that leap out at folks?
The one on homeless youth. What, I don't have the documents in front of me, what was that funding specifically going to go for?
Purchase of the building and also going to Dial Self as well for administration. Was it just, I can't remember.
It's less than half.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It wasn't less.
So
we're going to ask. Oh, right. It was considerably less than half. So we're looking at $750,000 proposal
right.
Or something, right?
It's like an
800.
I think
I thought
we
had
a
mistake.
It's so low, but it would be
important. Yeah, $750,000 proposal. 37?
Yeah. 37
is just a whole acquisition.
So it's a great proposal.
$639 on our application.
I love it, but yeah. contributing to the acquisition of real estate.
Maybe our spreadsheet.
Oh, wait, right.
That's probably true.
Okay.
When we're contributing to the acquisition of real estate, I think the committee has to protect the CPA's interest in longevity what happens if things in school somehow, and what position we are on the mortgage, because this is taxpayer money. So that this should be, simply because of the nature of the proposal, it's number one proposal as far as priorities go for me, but it nonetheless, because of its very nature, there's a lot of things that need to be, I think, stipulated if we're going to protect public money.
That's the most uncertain in a way.
I beg your pardon?
It's the most uncertain in a way, because they don't even
know which
house it.
And
there
we have
an affordable housing restriction put on it as requiring its use for this purpose.
Use that purpose, and if that particular house is, if there's a sale, then exactly what we anticipate. I came on board here shortly before we gave all that money to First Church's First Century, and it had significant restrictions on them as a result, and that's why they couldn't sell the windows. If we give a significant amount of money to this project, and I'm glad we are, then what restrictions will be placed on that building as a result of our grant? Will that be, if it was a building were sold in 5 years from now because of the better, more suitable building that came available, would we have some say in that? What would the public's interest be in that process? That's all I'm asking. I mean, obviously, I'm for it.
Yeah. It sounds like, from what he said, the interest would be that it couldn't be used for anything but, the purposes that it was purchased for.
I mean, the concept of CPA money is that it's there and doing good for a long time to come, nobody can convert it to other use. So that if the building were sold, what happens at that point? Is it just automatically rolled over?
The restriction is recorded in the registry of deeds. It affects the title to the property, and the new owner is subject to that restriction. So somebody's not going to buy it unless they intend to.
What if some? Oh, and that, I could see that. What if somebody said, "Well, we'd like to return the building to public, consumer stock, and instead we want to the housing for homeless youth wants to buy a new building and use the money we get from the sale of this old building to acquire our new and better building, more suitable building, more resources for more kids. And so the previous building we've helped them buy, now it returns to consumers. So it's not, there is no hold on it any longer. It's sort of, do we just say, well, that's fine as long as it's going for another, for good use? But we could, it's fine, but it just, there's that. I mean, because it's real.
Yeah. Doesn't the affordable housing restriction go to the real estate?
Yes,
it goes with the deed. You can't function it out.
Even if we didn't condition that, other funding agencies would allow that. So they're stuck with it, using that building as exactly what they're proposing to do with it for probably 99 years.
So they have to, their board has to understand that once they buy it, the CPA money fixes that as public housing forever, which is because the loan they get from United Bank or Bank of America or something could say, well, wherever you're going to go,
the other sources of funding are more stringent than what.
Yeah. So what we're saying is we might need, but that affects the equity in the property. If forever, if from that point on it can only be used for low-income housing, then, but they themselves say, well, that was good back in 2016, but we got grown in. You were shaking your head.
They can't do that. They could go do another one, but they can't swap the real estate.
It can be in addition to. It couldn't be instead of.
And that's what I'm talking about having. I mean, that may be fine with them, but that if you're putting together a package that consists of something that nails down that property as in perpetuity for that purpose, that's going to affect how much a bank is going to want to loan to it, because it can't. It's no longer a fungible property. It's sort of, it can only be used for that purpose.
I think they're doing a lot of fundraising, so it's not as if they're trying to take out a loan, in addition to the CPA funds, which will pay down the acquisition price.
Mm-hmm. Rich?
Can we check with them what the status of their other two buildings are? How they handled it with regard to the other two?
I was just looking at the contract for the sober housing. That had a condition that required an affordable housing restriction, which they were going to do anyway, because of other funding sources, just because they wanted to. That's their mission. Housing shall be limited for 99 years to households at or below 60% of AMI, and for the first 30 years to households at or below 30% of AMI. They also didn't know what houses they were going to purchase at that point, so we said it has to be located in Northampton. We specified the minimum number of residents that it would serve. We required commitment from their service provider, which was Gandara, for that house, of services going forward, and then that's it.
So we have that option to set conditions that specify the length of time from, I think we've done 30 to 99 years, is that correct? As low as 30 and as long as 99. Of what percent of income, whatever that's called, we've done that. We've done supportive services, we've put conditions on that. What's the fourth one?
Number of residents.
And number of residents. So all of those are things that we can consider and can certainly put in conditions.
And again, all my comments are supportive. I think it's a great project. I just think that this is, it strikes me as just one project that's going to need a bunch of
conditions. Any other conditions? We're a little over time, but that's okay. Any other conditions that leap out on at us?
I don't know if you take that in the opposition.
The question is, any other conditions that leap out at us at this point? Otherwise, there is no other business not on the agenda, correct? We're meeting back in 2 weeks, which is the what?
20th,
thank you. April 20th. If Downey was here as our chair, he'd be able to tell us what the Sox game score is, because he would have been watching his computer and not listening to the conversation the whole time. But without Downey, we're forced to turn on the radio. 105.5 FM, for those of you that don't know and are not Sox fans on our way home. Is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
All in favor? Yep. Yeah.